just rise for the Pledge of Allegiance?
To the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
I just want to let you know we were late because we had the auditors, so we apologize for being a little late. Roll call, Betty, please.
Mr. Amidits.
Here.
Mrs. Buckley.
Here.
Mr. Christensen. Mrs. Cook. Mrs. Dobus.
Here.
Mr. Means.
Here.
Mr. Nagel.
Here.
Mrs. Rule.
Here.
Mr. Workmeister.
Here.
Seven members present.
We're now going to have some presentations. Our first one going to be with our auditors from Cipher and Cipher.
Thank you, Mrs. Rule. Evening, board members, and to the public. Thanks for having us here tonight. We have a very short presentation for you on the results of the 17-18 audit. If we flip there to page two, the audit is required by the state and federal government. School code calls for an annual audit of the district statement. The important thing for everyone to keep in mind is that the auditors work for the school board and indirectly to the public. We use government auditing standards, and at the end of an audit, we give you an opinion. There are three possible opinions: adverse, modified, unmodified. The opinion you've received from us this year is an unmodified opinion. That's exactly what you expect to get. Anything less than that is unacceptable. So Bethel Park has achieved its objective in that regard. Last year, the general fund brought in revenue of various types, local, state, and federal. The local revenue is primarily tax revenue, form of real estate, owned income tax, transfer taxes, and so forth. $61.9 million, almost $62 million. The state contributed some $23.8 million to the district. Comes in the form of various subsidies for Social Security, Medicare, and various state programs, including the ESB. And then small amount of federal revenue, $374,000, for a total of $86.046 million. Moving over to the next page, where did we spend all of our money this year? The biggest expenditure is instruction. We have many students. We have to pay for teacher salaries, we pay for benefits, we pay for classroom supplies, so on and so forth. Last year, that number was some $52 million, 51.6. Support services. This is the administration, the business office, transportation, the people who maintain and keep our building. Classroom aids, some $21,062,000. Non-instructional, principally athletics, so forth. Student activities, $1,529,000. Small amount of capital outlay, $56,000. But the reason for that is we spend a majority of the money in for capital out of our capital project fund. Debt service last year was some $6.7 million. And one of the smart moves that the board made this year and in other years, we decided to save some money. We transferred about $4.7 million out to the capital project fund. None of the buildings that we have, you know, even the high school, as new as it is, will need some maintenance, and we found that out today. So in anticipation of future needs, $4.8 million was transferred over to capital projects for the year. If we move on to the next page, the unassigned fund balance, and that's our savings account. Every one of us runs a household. I do, you do. We need money in the bank in order to properly do our bill, make sure that we can save for tomorrow and so forth. We were able to increase that by a small amount this past year, $457,000. And so moving to the next page, what you can see here is that unreserved, undesignated fund balance came in at slightly less than $6 million. That sounds like a lot, but when you consider that we spend some $81 million, that's only about 6.85%. So it's not even 10% of what you spend we have in the checkbook to start running the new school year with. So this is very tight. It's within the state federal guidelines for fund balance, so we're doing an appropriate job there. Future challenges faced by Bethel Park. School board's well aware of these. Excuse me. Health insurance rates are expected to increase. I have a number of clients who have December renewals. They're seeing 15 to 20% increases. Don't know what's going to happen here. Unknowns regarding state funding decreases, or even the potential that we might have an increase. Uncertainty regarding federal funding in the coming years. And then finally, our share of the PISA's contribution are still continuing to go up. They're going to go up probably another 2.5% or an additional $1 million increase annually for the next 5 years. The only thing I can tell you folks, it's the single most devastating thing that school districts are experiencing right now, is that we have to pay a full 33% of payroll to fund retirement. And the reason that retirement fund was mismanaged at the state level, none of y'all had anything to do with that. And it was mismanaged 16 straight years. And it's not only our retirement system for the public school employees, but it's the state employees' retirement system. It's across the board. If we move over to the capital fund, adding $4.7 million brings our number to $11.5 million worth of capital expenditure money available for future needs, and we're going to have them. This talks about PISA. As you can see, the rate increases here have slowed, and they're projected to level off at some 36%, 36.5% by the year 2025. That may be optimistic. There's nothing you can do about it, but the key thing is talk to your legislature. They're the people that could do something about it. And maybe they will, maybe they won't. Lastly, I'd like to compliment the administration of the school district. They do a fine job for the board. I'd also like to thank the board for the opportunity to be the district's auditor. If there's any questions, we'd be happy to answer them. Thank you all very much.
Thank you. Any questions? Thank you.
Have a good night.
Thank you. We now have a presentation to Lincoln PTO. Later this evening, the board will be accepting a donation from the Abraham Lincoln Elementary School PTO for the purchase and installation of new curtains for the Lincoln stage. This gesture of generosity is valued at $4,200. These curtains are a prominent feature in the school's multi-purpose room, and they replace what the PTO believes to be the original curtains from when the school was built in 1965. So you know they were due to be replaced. The Lincoln PTO board and membership unanimously approved this purchase and contracted with the local company, Pittsburgh Stage, to do the installation, which was completed within 2 weeks of the purchase, just in time for all of Lincoln's holiday concerts and assemblies. If you look at the screens in the room, you will see two pictures of the new curtains from the front of the stage as well as from behind. And I think you will agree that the new curtains look fabulous and will serve our students well into the future, and hopefully for another 53 years. If you read my message in the December Bethel Park Chronicles, that's on a Gulf message, you know how much this board appreciates all of the efforts of our PTA and PTO members and the countless hours they donate to provide our students with many wonderful activities, programs, trips, and equipment that might not otherwise be possible within the district's normal operating budget. This generous donation from the Lincoln PTO falls just in that category, and we are extremely appreciative of all the time and effort that went into raising the funds for this much-needed enhancement to the school. With me this evening are the Lincoln co-presidents Sarah Hughes and Casey Elphinstone. Ladies, would you please join me up front to receive a certificate of appreciation from the board, thanking you and your membership for this generous donation. We greatly appreciate your efforts. We have another presentation at this time. And this time we'll be presenting this evening, it's the board's pleasure to donate a book to the Independence Middle School Library in memory of Beverly Fassinger, the mother of Vicki Flota, our Director of Public Relations, who passed away last month at the good age of 91. Beverly was someone who loved life and did her best to enjoy every day. She had a great sense of humor and liked to have fun. She loved to play cards, knit, and volunteer her time at her church in the blood bank. She was the kind of person people came to for advice because she listened to them and her advice was always honest. She could sugarcoat it when you needed it, but she wasn't afraid to give it to you straight either. She was a champion for the underdog, especially when it came to children. She was always watching out for the kids in the neighborhood or at the neighborhood swimming pool, making sure that everyone felt welcome and included. That's why we have purchased a copy of the book, Puddin', by Julie Murphy in her memory. This book is the sequel to Dumplin', which just came out as a Netflix movie with Dolly Parton. Puddin' is the story about two teenage girls who form an unlikely friendship. And it's a story that Beverly would approve of because it's what she would want for all kids, to get past first appearance and stereotypes and get along. Vicki, we extend our sympathies to you. We hope this book will serve as a lasting memory of your mother. We also hope that this book serves as an inspiration to the students who read it and to feel empowered and to put aside the boundaries of peer pressure and follow their dreams. Vicki, please come up and accept this book. I am now going to have Dr. Pasquarella give an overview of Act 44.
Thank you, Mrs. Rule. Before I go into a brief overview of Act 44, I did want to make one announcement with regards to the high school. Many of you should have gotten the phone call if you have high school students, but today at our high school, due to what we believe to be a frozen pipe that broke the sprinkler. The dampler was left open that busted the sprinkler pipe. We had a water leak. Therefore, we will need one more day to continue to to clean up, ready, and make the place healthy and safe for our students to return on Thursday. So that is our plan. We appreciate all of the staff who are working diligently to prepare that, all the students and teachers and entire support staff who helped to make that transition today as smooth as possible, and to all the parents who helped to be understanding through that incident that we didn't know was going to occur, and to work with us as the district as we're going to work diligently over the next X hours to be able to open up. If by chance, for some reason, something were to go wrong, we'd be back in contact with you, but we anticipate it to reopen on Thursday. We'll let you know if anything changes. And again, that's only for the high school. The rest of the schools will be in attendance tomorrow. For Act 44, so I'm going to go over some of the provisions, and some of these are still coming forth from the state as we go. We attend trainings regularly, webinars as a team, but I will lay out some of them and then have a brief couple bullets on each one of them. So first, mandates the appointment of a school safety and security coordinator. B, creates the school safety and security committee within PA. Expands PA State Police Risk and Vulnerability Assessment Team Unit. Establishes mandatory school safety training for all school entity employees. Establishes standards for school police, school resource officers, and school security guards. And establishes Safe to Say Something program in the Attorney General's office. So I'm going to touch on each of those briefly. So for the school safety and security coordinator, you needed to do this and appoint somebody by August 31st, 2018. We completed that. We recommended and approved Leonard Carazzi as that individual. However, he reports directly to me, the chief school administrator. However, he also oversees, and we work as a team with our school police, our school resource officers, security. He also helps to review policies with our entire administrative staff. He coordinates school safety and security surveys, reports to the board, which he has to do annually, June 30th, which is really also a team effort. Many of our principals are starting to have, and many of you may have been aware of this, building level safety meetings with parents, where they're having those along with our drills that we're practicing, and then they'll compile that all into one large report that Mr. Carazzi will report on by June 30th of the year. And he also serves as a liaison to our committee in PDE and law enforcement, and he often gets many of the emails that come forth from the state that allow us to know what our next steps would be. B, school safety and security committee. 9/30/2018, this is to establish criteria for school safety and security assessments. This is a state committee, not a district committee, that was established. And on 10/31/18, they were to create a survey for all school entities to measure safety and security throughout PA. This survey was due on 11/30/18, which we did complete. The anticipated results are late January or sometime in February, pending any delay. They also were to administer grants. One of those grants is on the agenda tonight for $25,000, in which we're going to be recommending, and hopefully the board will approve, lock pins to secure doors. We also, even though it was not mandated, we're also put a submission into a competitive grant for just shy of $100,000 for bus cameras. I know recently they didn't say exactly when they would let us know the results of that. However, I know they were inventorying or asking people to join that to be advisors recently. So I don't think we'll hear till probably in the spring. The RVAT unit, there's no real information at this point. However, the idea is that it's supposed to expand PA State Police to create risk and vulnerability assessments. The idea is that it should be created by March 31st of 2019. That's their goal, where they'll create three teams that will serve three different geographic regions, and all of the schools will have the opportunity, hopefully, at that point, to get on their list for them to come out and view our schools. Training. It established mandatory school safety training for the entire school entity and all the employees to train staff on situational awareness, trauma-informed education awareness, behavioral health, suicide and bullying awareness, substance use awareness, and emergency drills. Trainings may be online if necessary and must complete a minimum of 3 hours every 5 years. We completed this, and when I say we completed it, we had 3 hours worth of the training. That doesn't mean that's not something that we will continue to do throughout the next years, but we did complete at least the 3 hours. We had a training from John D'Angelo from Tri-County EMT to cover many of those topics, and Joel Dixon, our school resource officer, as well as practicing our ALICE drills. Standards for school police, SRO, and security. Basically, Article 13C said that they should have CPR, AED, which all of ours do. They have to go down and receive an oath of office downtown, which they have done. They need a shield and a badge while on duty, which we have. They have to do firearm training in accordance with the municipalities, much like our police, which they're able gracefully by the goodwill of the Bethel Park Police Department. They go down and acquire this training and recertify themselves in the firearm training. And they also have 12 hours of in-service in and around new laws and application annually, which we give them time to do. Actually, it's a great opportunity for them. There's going to be a training in the evening, which they're going to be willing to go on 2 evenings, so that hopefully they'll be able to remain in the school district during school hours. Safe to say something. It's an anonymous tip line, 24/7 for school safety, mandated for all schools. The program began January 14th, 2019. However, you weren't allowed to start training both your staff and your students until after that day, once the system became live. So we have completed that today, actually, with our staff, and our students' in-person training at this point is scheduled for Friday, January 25th. You also must work with law enforcement. We completed that. We met with Detective Dixon and also Lieutenant Blake Babin from the Bethel Park Police Department on 1/4/19. And as a result of that meeting, Babin and Dixon trained and notified and directed all Bethel Park Police Department on the Safe to Say app and how we would handle that per the training. We also have to develop procedures, which PSBA did develop our procedures, and we provided those to the board. They don't need a formal vote as they are procedures, but we provided them. That concludes my brief overview of Act 44 at this given point.
Thank you. I need a motion now for intent to adopt the agenda for business items.
So moved.
Second.
Okay. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries as stated. Approval of the minutes. I need a motion for the regular meeting minute of November 13, 2018, and reorganization meeting minutes of December 4, 2018.
So moved.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries as stated. Announcement of executive session January 15, 2019 for personnel, other legal matters, and to receive information. January 22, 2019 for personnel, other legal matters, and to receive information. At this time, I'd like to ask Dr. Pasquarelli. He has a recognition for the school board.
This time of year is when we annually pause and take a few well-deserved moments to recognize our school directors for their hard work and dedication. The Pennsylvania School Boards Association has proclaimed January as School Director Recognition Month, and we are more than happy to join in this yearly celebration to thank our directors for their time, their effort that they make to the Bethel Park School District to make it the very best it can be. According to PSBA, Pennsylvania school directors voluntarily put in an average of 20 hours per month for school board business, and I would guess that our directors, as devoted as they are, spend at least this time to fully understand all of the issues that are facing not only our schools in Bethel Park, but but also the region, state, and nation. School directors advocate on behalf of our schools, students, and community, making our students' success their top priority. And we thank them for your investment of time and effort for the good of all of our children. Making students' success a top priority is sometimes challenging as school directors face many issues and obstacles, such as an increase in costs, unfunded government mandates, but the board does its very best to keep a collective eye on what's important, and that is providing our students with the best opportunities to be successful in life. As it is our custom each year, it is our pleasure to recognize you this evening in the celebration of School Director Recognition Month and present you with a few tokens of our appreciation for all you do. Start to pass those out. First, in the envelope, we have a certificate from PSBA and a copy of the annual proclamation the organization issues each January in honor of School Director Recognition Month.
Thank you.
In the bag, we have a little treat to thank you for all that you do to make Bethel Park School District a great place to learn and work. At this time, I would ask the audience to join me in a round of applause for our 9 school directors as we recognize them and thank them for everything they do. We look forward to work. Oh, yeah. Forgot my applause. Thank you. And we look forward to working with you in 2019 to ensure the continued success of the Bethel Park School District as a leader in public education.
Thank you. Staff reports.
There has been so much going on in the Bethel Park School District since our last report to you in November. So sit back and enjoy all of the good news we have to share with you this evening. Dr. Pasquarella and I had the pleasure of attending the Title I Distinguished Schools Award Ceremony at the Sheridan and Station Square on Monday to cheer on Franklin Principal Teresa Dumont and Penn Principal Brian Lanoski as they received the Title I Distinguished Schools Award from the Pennsylvania Department of Education's Division of Federal Programs. Franklin and Penn were two of the 153 Pennsylvania schools to be recognized for meeting all of the measurable objectives set by the state. Only 5% of the state's Title I schools earned this distinction, and we are extremely proud of the staff and students at both of these schools for their efforts to bring this distinction to Bethel Park. Franklin Elementary fourth grade teachers Jennifer Gallagher and Amy Lazader were selected to receive Apple Awards from the Pennsylvania chapter of the National State Teacher of the Year. The award is presented to Pennsylvania educators to recognize their exceptional efforts in teaching, coaching, and other efforts to support educational excellence. Recipients are chosen because they make a positive difference in the lives of their students, school districts, and community. Ms. Gallagher and Ms. Lazader were nominated by Franklin fourth grade teacher and 2017 PA Teacher of the Year finalist, Catherine Mucci. Congratulations to these two teachers for this well-deserved recognition. The district received notice late last week that Neil Armstrong Middle School is one of the 765 Pennsylvania schools selected to receive a $35,000 PA Smart Initiative targeted grant, which will expand computer science classes and teacher training at NAMS. For the first part of the grant, 3 NAMS staff members, Mr. Patterson, Mr. Wargo, and Mrs. Minnick, will participate in training to help ensure that all NAMS students are exposed to computer science learning opportunities at the 5th and 6th grade levels. We are excited about receiving this funding and will continue to explore additional funding through this initiative as it becomes available. Bethel Park High School junior Miranda Johns received the Excellence in Biology Award from Seton Hill University at its Women in Science Day event. Miranda was nominated for this award by Bethel Park High School science teacher Barbara Eisel based on her interest in an excellent academic record in biology classes at Bethel Park High School. At the Women in Science Day event, Miranda was able to meet female science professionals and professors and participate in some mini lab experiments involving hands-on analysis of high-level data. Miranda would like to major in biology in college in preparation for a career as an optometrist. Bethel Park High School biology teacher Alex Winchell recently participated in a research experience for teachers program at the University of Pittsburgh, which is funded by the National Science Foundation. The program immersed teachers in a design-oriented class to help them transfer the skills they learned in the program to their classroom to help their students with STEM projects. Mr. Winchell decided to challenge his students to focus on honeybees, specifically developing the bees can conserve energy so they have more time to pollinate flowers and produce more honey. The students worked in teams to design a honeycomb on CAD and use the 3D printer in their classroom to print out their designs. Mr. Winchell then took the student-produced honeycombs and inserted them into the beehive he has at his home containing 40,000 honeybees. The students also did research and created posters about the honeybees. Mr. Winchell is entering this project into a national STEAM design competition. We will let you know if our students are winners. Bethel Park High School students earned 31 awards at the 2018 PA DECA District 3 Career Development Conference, including 13 first place, 14 second place, and 4 third place awards. All of the students will now advance to the DECA State competition, which will be held in February in Hershey. Congratulations to all the students whose names are on the screens before you. Special congratulations to the first place finishers at the local level: Zach Lucido, Sierra Roach, Lexi Schenk, Ryan Torles, Hunter Dorfner, Marcus McKittrick, Caleb Shook, Jenna Chernicki, Sarah Gillum, Christian McLean, Leah Pizzazzi, Anastasia Antonucci, Kate Sullivan, Swajeki Barrel, Isabel Burke, Abby Griffith, and Brooke Fife. Good luck to everyone at States. The Rotary Club of Bethel Park named Bethel Park High School senior Rosie Daly its November Student of the Month, senior Anthony Lucchetti its December Student of the Month, and junior Alexis Kilsling its January Student of the Month. Each month during the school year, the Rotary recognizes a Bethel Park High School student for outstanding commitment to school and or community. Congratulations to all three of these deserving students. Bethel Park High School students welcome students from 6 area school districts to the South Gym in December for the second annual Rock Your Holiday Sweater Party, featuring games, dancing, photos, crafts, and of course, lots of holiday sweaters. This activity helps the students to improve their social skills and interpersonal interactions. This coalition of schools gets together throughout the year to participate in several activities, such as bowling, movies, sporting events, and a prom. 30 Bethel Park High School students successfully auditioned and were selected to participate in the Pennsylvania Music Educators Association's District Chorus Concert, which will take place on February 8th at Mount Lebanon High School. Representing Bethel Park in this event will be Jessica Abraham, Alexander Yankoviak, Jane Baranak, Alex Brownfield, Sarah Bucci, Kelly Fedko, Andrew Fullerton, John Gummo, Molly Hoffman, Abby Carrick, Abalash Krishnashadad, Bill Kumar, Ashley Lewis, Anthony Lucchetti, Ryan Markle, Caitlin Markovicchio, Colin McCormick, Brian Pauly, Sarah Pellis, Connor Remington, Morgan Ripley, Kelsey Rogers, Maddie Schleidler, Cam Silman, Julianne Stein, Jerry Varghese, Olivia Vicuccio, Anthony Will, Janelle Wu, and Marissa Wykinski. As far as we can determine, this is the largest group of Bethel Park High School students to participate in this event in the last 16 years. Congratulations to all these students. 13 Bethel Park High School musicians played in the Pennsylvania Music Educators Association District Orchestra Concert, which was held earlier this month at North Allegheny High School. Congratulations to Sarah Bucci, Kobe Coleman, Roma Eisel, Kaylee Flood, Grace Geely, Anthony Lucchetti, Elijah Nice, Emma Petrick, Connor Remington, Teresa Stolpa, Olivia Tablier, Vincent Fuccicchio, and Janelle Wu. Congratulations to the 8 Bethel Park High School musicians who will play in the Pennsylvania Music Educators Association District Band Concert, which will be held on Saturday, January 6th at Cornell High School. Representing Bethel Park in this event will be Sarah Bucci, Roma Eisel, Sarah Fulton, Elijah Nice, Connor Remington, Jackson Stewart, Teresa Stolpa, and Olivia Tabler. 2 Bethel Park High School freshmen and 6 Independence Middle School students will represent Bethel Park in the Pennsylvania Music Educators Association's Junior High District Orchestra Concert, which will be held on March 23rd at Upper St. Clair High School. Congratulations to Bethel Park High School musicians Aiden Allridge and Sarah D'Angelo, as well as Independence Middle School musicians Jasmine Cable, Kobe Heinrich-Bondra, Clara McGoo, Rebecca Tupper, Angelina Velasaris, and Samantha Wolf. The Bethel Park High School Varsity Competitive Cheerleading Squad is having a great season. They won the WIPUL Championship for the second consecutive year and the state championship for the second time in 3 years. They will travel to Orlando, Florida in February to compete in the national championships, and we wish them the best. We will be inviting them to join us in February for recognition once their competitive season concludes. Good luck to the cheerleaders and coaches at Nationals. The Bethel Park Athletic Hall of Fame inducted 7 new members in December. Congratulations to Ray Bedner, Nick Bonacorsi, Dean Gabby, Lyle Marsh, Ulysses Scott, Don Smith, and Jim Sprandle. 13 Independence Middle School female students had the opportunity to participate in the American Heart Association's Go Red, Go STEM event at Carnegie Science Center. This event was designed to empower women, improve their overall well-being, and help them to consider pursuing a STEAM-related career that would positively impact the health of all Americans. Participating in the event were eighth graders Lydia Bloom, Victoria D. Pasquale, Catherine Kroll Schaus, Malia Mazzaro, Katie McWiggin, Allison Morgan, Charlotte Noss, Naomi Noss, Grace Passios, Grace Sabo, Natalie Sager, Bella Testa, and seventh grader Lexi Tokolvi. The functional skills class at Neil Armstrong Middle School earned first place at the annual gingerbread holiday display at the PPG Place Winter Garden. This year, the students built a beautiful Disney Christmas-themed castle, which earned them a blue ribbon. This house and several others that they made were on display downtown during the holiday season. We hope you had a chance to visit and be amazed at all of the great entries. For years, Neil Armstrong Middle School students have raised money and used that money for the sixth graders to go shopping to purchase Christmas presents for distribution to the needy by worthy charities. This year, the students shopped for Operation Santa Claus, which supports the children of parents who are serving in the military. The presents were distributed locally at a holiday carnival sponsored by the Bridges Kids Club. This year, one of the gifts was received by Chase Pagano, who is son of Bethel Park High School graduate Staff Sergeant Elizabeth Caulfield Pagano. She was pleasantly surprised when she opened the gift at the carnival to discover that it was purchased by the students on Team Odyssey at Neil Armstrong. So she and Chase paid a visit to NAMS right before Christmas break to thank the students for their generosity. She was able to meet four of the five students who purchased the tractor for Chase, students Jack Harry, Adam Lackey, Matthew Rashudio, and Blaze Roberto were super excited to meet Staff Sergeant Pagano and Chase and have their picture taken with them. Jonathan Campagna was also a part of the shopping group, but was not in school on the day of the visit. One of the students said that meeting the recipients of their gift made it the best Christmas ever. Once again, we thank the generosity of the Rotary Club of Bethel Park for purchasing a copy of a student's dictionary for every one of our third grade students. These books are the students' personal copies to keep and use throughout their school years. The dictionaries will be especially handy as the students prepare for the annual third grade spelling bee, also sponsored by the Rotary. This year's bee will be held on May 9th at Neil Armstrong Middle School. We look forward to another great event. Lincoln Elementary students are working across all grade levels to develop a maker mindset this year. Four times each year, the students are grouped with students from other grades and they rotate through four STEAM sessions that are designed to help them develop the four qualities of a growth mindset: integrity, grit, creativity, and confidence. By grouping the students across grade levels, they are able to build relationships with one another as well as with different members of the Lincoln staff. This year, Memorial Elementary School has formed an Odyssey of the Mind team, and seven students are meeting every week to prepare for the competition that will occur sometime in March. Odyssey of the Mind is a creative problem-solving program involving students from kindergarten through college. Team members work together at length to solve a predefined long-term problem and present their solution to the problem at a competition. This year's team selected a problem where they have to build a vehicle that is able to transport them through three specific rescue missions. They are working on a skit and costumes as well. Memorial parents are working with the students on this creative activity. Good luck to the students in this competition. 50 Memorial students are staying after school one night a week for 9 weeks to participate in a STEAM program that has them completing two projects each week based on weekly themes such as engineering and architect, force and motion, magnets, and robotics and coding. Memorial parents are working with the students and they are assisted by Neil Armstrong Middle School students who also volunteer to work with students. Congratulations to Washington third grader Ava Friday, who was one of the 10 national runners-up in Scholastic Books Art and Writing Invention Contest. Ava's invention was called the Get Ready Dresser, and she explains her invention this way. You put in your feeling, and it gives you your outfit and food. And if you don't like what you got, you can put in your feeling again. For her effort, she was able to choose her prize from among six different maker kits. I wanted to share with you a couple examples of how Hawk Time is working in our elementary schools. At Franklin, second graders were working with Mrs. Galloway and Mrs. Carr to learn about place value. Students were given large pieces of paper with a single digit on it, and then they came to the front of the class in groups of three to make three-digit numbers. The students sitting on the floor had the opportunity to share their knowledge of three-digit numbers by saying which number was in the hundreds column, which number was in the tens column, and what number was in the ones column. Then the students holding the numbers had fun rearranging themselves to make the largest and smallest three-digit number possible using the numbers they were holding. Next, they move on to four-digit numbers in the thousands column. At Penn, Mrs. Thomas's first grade students learned about high-frequency words by playing the favorite children's game, I Spy. Once the students found the words that were hidden on a worksheet, they were tasked with using the word in a sentence. The students enjoy learning through gameplay, with one student explaining that Hawk Time is so cool. Visitors to William Penn are amazed at the newly created Dr. Seuss theme wall that was hand-drawn and painted by art teacher Kelly Eckerd Graffam over a three-week period. The wall depicts many of her favorite Dr. Seuss characters, all doing things that students learn in character education, such as cooperation, trying hard, being kind, and accepting of others. Across from the feature wall was a bulletin board filled with Dr. Seuss-style thank you notes that the students wrote to Mrs. Eckerd Graffam expressing their enthusiasm for the beautiful addition to their school. Here is our monthly reminder slide about our vision for the 2018-2019 school year, Innovative Mindsets. And as you can see, this month we had several examples of how our teachers are working to help their students to develop an innovative mindset. It's hard to believe, but we're already beginning the registration process for the 2019-2020 school year. And an important part of the process is kindergarten pre-registration in advance of kindergarten registration in March. Parents whose children will be age 5 on or before September 1st, 2019 are eligible to register their children for kindergarten in the fall. Please go to our website or any of the elementary school's websites to print off the kindergarten pre-registration form. Once completed, please return it to your child's elementary school and then begin to complete the kindergarten registration packet in advance of registration in March. Parents who have questions are encouraged to contact their child's school. Thanks to everyone for pre-registering and registering their child for kindergarten. It is a great help to the district. And that concludes my report for this evening.
Thank you, Mrs. Wells. Student government.
Hi, so one of the things that student government always tries to do is spread positive energy around our school and throughout the community too. And I'm sure you're all aware of the tragedy that happened at the Tree of Life Synagogue at the end of this past October. And so in the wake of that, student government did a project where we had a poster with a tree on it, and then we cut out a lot of die-cut leaves and had students write letters to the victims. After we filled the tree by pasting the leaves onto the poster, we hung it in the school for a while to spread positive energy. And then after that, we mailed it to the synagogue for them. Because it's such a difficult time for them, and something that we thought they would appreciate was just people from outside saying that they're supporting them.
Looking at future events at the high school, student government is working on the Spirit Week and Wish Week, which will occur usually around the week of Valentine's Day, and we usually do that to spread school spirit around.
Thank you. Good job. PTA, PTO.
Good evening. I'm Amber Steele, one of the co-presidents at Washington. I'll start with a report from Abraham Lincoln Elementary. Lincoln held their first PTO meeting of the new year on January 2nd. A school store and spirit day were held on January 18th, and a fundraising night at Chipotle is currently underway. Lincoln's yearly Jump Rope for Heart campaign for the American Heart Association will kick off with an assembly on January 28th, and the annual Lincoln Talent Show will be held on February 1st. Lincoln will participate in the district-wide collection for SHIM the week of February 11th. Canned meats and diapers will be collected. The PTO will be celebrating Abraham Lincoln's birthday with popcorn for all the students on February 12th. Next, Ben Franklin. Franklin is off to a wonderful start in 2019. They are collecting art and science contest forms in preparation for their annual event in February. Ben is continuously collecting box tops for monthly contests. They had to reschedule their ice skating party due to the bitter cold weather, but looking ahead, they're preparing for the Valentine's Day classroom parties in February, and next month they will host Ben Franklin's Readathon. George Washington Elementary recently concluded a drive for Colonel Greg Toth's platoon. Mrs. Toth is a teacher at our school, currently deployed with the U.S. National Guard. Before leaving, Colonel Toth provided a wish list for his soldiers to Mrs. Toth, who shared it with us. Parents and staff donated items towards the wish list, and we were able to fill the wishes of 56 individual soldiers and mail 28 boxes overseas to them. Students were happy to make thank you cards for all the soldiers. George Washington PTO is currently working towards their first STEM night coming up on January 25th, where students will make a bouncy ball, test out gliders, explore interesting float and sink experiments, inflate a balloon with baking soda, and many more things. It will be a great way to get those students thinking about the science fair scheduled for March. During the month of February, Washington students are going to kick off their jump rope for heart on February 7th and hold the actual jumping on February 28th. The students will get to show off their talents during their tryout preview day on February 5th as they prepare for our annual talent show held in April. Additionally, George Washington is going to team up with SHIM and collect the needed items the week of February 11th. Finally, Washington is going to celebrate George Washington's birthday on February 22nd with fun activities for all of the students. Memorial Elementary is having field trips for the fourth grade classes to the Clayton at Frick, and they went very well. The students had a great time learning about the local history, especially when it was decorated for the holidays. The kindergarten classes were thrilled with their trip to the Natural History Museum. The after-school STEM program started in January and has been a great success with almost 50 students attending the first session. The Odyssey of the Mind group is only a few weeks away from competition, and other elementary schools have reached out to get information on possibly starting clubs at their schools. WQED and Bethel Memorial will be hosting a creative family workshop in March with the PBS Kids Scratch Junior app. Memorial Movers practice will be starting running fitness practices in April and end with the Pittsburgh Kids Marathon. William Penn, they are in the process of restructuring their spring fundraiser that was formerly their largest one, the calendar party. They've formed a committee and are working on a new theme with an event planned for May 4th at the community center. On January 23rd, Junior Achievement will be coming to William Penn to teach classes to the kids all day. The PTO is providing a pizza party lunch as a thank you to these high school kids. They're in the process of forming a committee to plant a tree in the front circle of the building in honor of former principal Nicole Morris. Penn is also working with the Lincoln PTO to purchase t-shirts that will say, "Be the kind kid," for the teachers to wear once a week. And at Neil Armstrong, the Neil PTO has been busy fundraising for the upcoming field trip season in order to provide students with educational outings. The PTO provided funds for NAMS students to participate in and attend the Gingerbread House contest at PPG Place this December, the teams placed in their division. The largest NAMS charity event took place in December. The charity carnival raised funds to be distributed to SHIM and JDRF this year. A speaker from SHIM, Jim Guffey, spoke to the students prior to the carnival kickoff, and a total of $6,380 was raised. Continued fundraising efforts include Popcorn Fridays, School Store, Spirit Nights, and the upcoming Battle of the Books and Readathon. And last but not least, Independence Middle School. The IMS PTSO hosted a Spirit Night at Chipotle earlier this month, and they are busy helping with the funding of the awesome Boys Only Leadership Development and Girls Only Leadership Development programs for the eighth graders that will both take place over the next few weeks. Thanks.
Thank you. Solicitor? No reports? Committee reports. Pam?
I can report. I did some of the reporting last week at the committee meeting, but I can go over it a bit. At the Recreation Department, we talked about the lights in the parking lots, and we found out last week that they're on order and they're going to be replaced as soon as the guide rails are finished, particularly along Black Hawk Road, and also that there's going to be a fence installed at the back of the softball field for easier access for the emergency vehicles to come in, and also to put some gravel down to make the road a little bit wider, although it's wide enough for our trucks right now. I think that's an accurate summary of what we said last week. The Recreation Department is going to have a comedy night this weekend, January 26th. They're going to have a cornhole tournament March 23rd. They're pursuing shuffleboard and shuffleboard leagues for people to participate in, first of all at the community center, and then possibly move it to outdoor to because it's viewed as a all age kind of a thing. We're looking at the recommendation from the council is to join with us to do Live Well Allegheny. And we are talking about that, and Mr. Means and Mr. Workmeister are going to be the people that work with the council members in addition to Mr. Consul Magno to help us become a healthier community, both in the schools and in the community. Adopt a Park is still in its initial stages, but if anybody is interested in adopting one of the parklets to plant flowers and make sure that it keeps, attention is paid to it. The council is looking for people to adopt a park. Shade Tree Commission is starting its work now to develop plans to plant trees around Bethel Park in different areas and possibly on the schools and the parks, but also along roadways and so forth to help with the environment. And the Recreation Department has challenge grants. They're looking for ideas, recommendations, proposals to spend money to improve the recreational facilities, and those are due on March 31st, and you can find out information about that online under the Rec Department. That's it.
Thank you, Mrs. Rule. I will defer to you as far as the Pathfinder monthly meeting. I was unable to attend, so Mrs. Rule was kind enough to take that for me. But I do have some information as far as the January 9th PTO council meeting that we held here, the large group meeting. A lot of information was shared, and we had representation from administration and the principals, and Mr. Consul Magno was here, and of course all the moms who are very involved in the PTO. And I would just like to say that all of the information that you heard this evening in the PTO report that was just given, PTO, PTA Council, I hope that everyone sitting in the audience, as well as those folks at home, are listening carefully to all the many positive things that are happening in this district. And most importantly, these folks are volunteers as well. And they step up. They step up more than you can imagine. So people in the audience, people at home, if you're looking for something positive and helpful to do for our children and the staff and everyone in this school district, go online to the different school sites and look and see all the many, many things they're doing. And I'm sure with clearances and all the things that are appropriate, they might be looking for some volunteers. So why not step up and read some positive things on Facebook and help our kids? Thank you.
Thank you. Yes, Mrs. Buckley, I did attend Pathfinder for you, and they are in the process of finishing the roof, that project, and it will cost about $700,000. We are part of that consortium for Pathfinder. We will share in the costs, and we will be getting those costs for our July budget for next year, and that should complete at least the roof project. Also, I went to Shasta. They had their meeting, and we had the attorneys come in and spoke to us about Title IX and all the implications and all the interpretations and everything that we need to be aware of. And Dr. Pasquale, you attended too. Was there anything you wanted to add onto that?
No, I think it was informative, and although you can't possibly go over everything that falls under, they advise that if you have any questions to seek that out through your school district solicitor. And in general, there's some helpful tips.
Thank you. And Steel Center, our career technical education school, played host for the first time to the regional competition for Skills USA yesterday. Had an excellent turnout, got a good review. So we'll be getting more information on that. And those are the three things that were happening this past week. Okay, next. This is the time now where we have public comments on agenda items. Are there none on the agenda items? All right.
Yeah,
okay, I'm sorry. Please state your name and your address.
Kimberly Walsh Turner, 5828 Glen Hill Drive in Bethel Park. I attended the council committee meeting last week, and it had come up about the start of school on August 19th, and there were some concerns for those of us that have students in high school about the WPIAL start date. Was wondering if that was going to be brought up tonight as part of the academic calendar when the WPIALs could start. The other thing was the concern with the tight schedule around the HVAC completion on August 10th, and teachers if you start on the 19th, going back on the 14th, is that all going to be completed? And then some concerns with starting and all of the activities that start 2 weeks prior to the school start and students not being able to get into the high school building if the HVAC is still going to be repaired. Concerning lifting for football, band students, indoor training, cross country, all of those things getting completed in a timely manner to start on the 19th and for our students to be ready for school, the building to be completed, and ready for athletics to start. So large concerns on the tight turnaround schedule on that.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Anyone else? Okay, then we'll move on now to our rest of our agenda. Curriculum Committee, Mrs. Buckley.
Thank you, Mrs. Rule. There are 7 items this evening under curriculum. Would any board members like any held out?
5 and 7, please.
I move under the curriculum committee number 1, independent study, number 2, school-sponsored overnight educational activities, which includes the 45th annual Harvard National Invitational Forensics Tournament in Cambridge, Massachusetts, February 15th to the 19th, B, the Pennsylvania Junior Academy of Science state competition at Penn State main campus in May, number 3, train the trainer for nonviolent crisis intervention training program. 4, STEM maker lab. And 6, local holidays.
Is there a second?
Second.
Okay. Items 1, 2, 3, 4, and 6 have been moved and seconded. Are there any questions or comments? If not, all those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Ayes have it. Motion carried as stated.
I now move number 5, the 2019-2020 school calendar.
Second.
Okay. Item 5 and 7.
I'm sorry. I was just doing
five.
Just five.
Okay.
I was doing them separately as she asked. Okay.
Just 5. Okay.
Just make sure.
Item 5 has been moved and seconded. Are there any questions or comments?
Based on all the emails, conversations, and feedback that we've had, I'd like to amend this motion to adopt what was presented to us as option 3 calendar with the school start date of the 26th of August and the end date of June 9th with graduation being June 13th.
I second that.
Okay. It has the amendment has been moved and seconded to amend item 5 to accept option 3, which is a school starting date of August 26th, ending June 9th, with graduation on the 13th. Are there any questions or comments?
So all you're voting on right now is whether
amendment.
Or not to amend the motion. Mm-hmm. You're not actually voting on the motion, just whether or not you want to amend it.
My only statement, again, I've shared before, I'll say it again, that I think not only for just the testing, not just because of testing, but I think that the earlier start dates are effective. And I did want to report back that Mr. Sloan did get back to me. He said that the approximate fall sports date would be August 12th. They did say that it could affect coaches' practices to an extent during in-service schedules, but that's a typical problem where coaches have to practice after in-service. So I just wanted to make that statement.
We got lots and lots of emails from people over the last week since we talked about the calendar the last time. There wasn't one email that wanted us to go with the calendar as it was presented. Every single email I received asked that we consider starting later. The Whipple starting on the 12th gives the sports teams 3 days of full day practices, and then everything after that would be half-day practices based on the schedule, the teaching schedule, and the school schedule. And I am also concerned about whether we're going to be able to finish the HVAC program. I mean, I think I have confidence that we'll be able to finish the HVAC project, but we have had experience where the HVAC projects in some of the schools have been extended beyond that. I just think that it would be in the best interest of our students and our families in the district if we start school 1 week later.
Are there any other comments?
Yeah, we have an option four here, which has a start date of the 21st and an end date of the 4th of June, which I think might work out better. If we push everything back to the 13th, I mean, the end date to the 9th, that's pretty late, and if we run into any problems with cancellations or anything, we could wind up with students going in to the 3rd week of June. So,
well, we do have a lot of makeup days listed at the bottom of those pages. There are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 makeup days. Oh, wait, this is option 3.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7.
The proposed school calendar we have.
11.
Yeah, so I don't think we'd have to move it.
Okay.
Any other comments? Okay, now we're voting on the amendment.
Voting on whether or not to amend
the motion. Okay, all those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed?
Aye.
Okay, ayes have it, and the amendment passes.
Okay, so now you are going back and voting on the actual motion. Of adopting the option 3 school calendar.
As amended. Yep,
as amended.
As amended. Right.
That is the amendment.
Yeah.
Option 3 okay. is the amendment.
Okay. Do we have to second? We already seconded.
That's already been moved. Okay. So you're just voting on that.
6.
Yeah.
Mrs. Rule, if I may, I know that we did receive some emails, and I've had some conversations with some employees, if you will, as well as being a former primary teacher, and there are some concerns. And the concern being how many days would be the first few weeks of school for the primary kids. And so that, I'm just setting this now, as far as the option 3. And if I'm looking at this correctly, because I didn't get time to study it because we just got it, the first day of school would be the 26th, and that's a full week of school. So that, for me, and in respect to the primary teachers and so on, that's a concern.
Mrs. Buckley, if you would want to propose another amendment to the option 3, and if you wanted 2 days to start school 2 days later in terms of the middle of the week, you could possibly take January 2nd and 3rd. I'm just suggesting if you'd want to make that amendment.
I hear what you're saying, Mrs. Dobas, but again, my concern is, see, the bottom line is this, folks, no matter what we do, we're not gonna make everybody happy. We've had schedules or calendars, if you will, in the past where we've started early, where we've started late, and some people complain we start too early, some people say start sooner, and whatever, so no matter what. But there's no one easy all fix to this. I'm just respectfully letting people know that there's a concern about 5-day weeks for starting for primary kids.
Yeah, I'm not going to make an amendment. If somebody else wants to do that, they can, but there were several of the emails reference the idea that they would prefer a middle of the week start.
I concur on that too. Yeah, it is a difficult situation. You guys don't know how many emails we get. We get a little mix on beginning of the week, the middle of the week. They want a longer Christmas vacation. They want to not end in June too late. They want. I mean, it's a little bit all over the place. But there's a little bit of a consensus here that people do not want to start too early. That seems to be a little bit more, so that's what we're trying to, I see it at least this way. We're trying to make some change to help accommodate. Nothing's going to be perfect, so we're going to vote on an amendment that's going to help get us closer. close. That's it. That's the way I see it.
Cindy, you want to make an amendment?
So do you want to make another amendment to the amended motion, or to start the middle of the week, or what? What is your pleasure?
Well, if we would do that, as far as making an amendment for the middle of the week, as Mr. Means had mentioned, the current option three would be getting out June 10th, bearing no weather or confusion. So that's not too late yet. But then when other things take place and then we add to the end, then people are going to complain that we're getting out too late. So where else could we fill those days?
That's what I said was you could take January 2nd and 3rd and you could start on the 28th.
And that would still leave 7 makeup
days. And it would
days.
Still, the calendar would pretty much remain the same.
Okay. And then I'm not trying to give you a hard time. I'm just
making a
statement here.
If you want to do that.
Yeah. And I'm looking
not
at
going
that.
To do
and then
that,
we're
going to
get complaints because we're taking away Christmas vacation. So, again.
Well, 2 weeks, yeah.
Yeah. So.
Yeah, we did have some emails commenting about it.
Yes,
your vacation,
about that.
Like,
right.
Yeah,
that's what I'm saying.
I mean, hey, it's.
I should have brought my tally marks because I did keep track of it, and I'm sorry I didn't bring that tonight, but I think the folks in the audience, I don't know if you'd be surprised or not, but there's quite a few tally marks there about, I want this, I want that, don't do it this way, who cares if they go in June, let the kids be hot. I mean, all kind of comments. So I don't know that we have a...
Mrs. Walsh, you put the calendar together with the union or the teachers?
We did originally, but to be fair, I mean, we looked at two options. Both of them were earlier starts than the 26th, and they picked it out of those that we prepared. They picked the one that had a longer holiday break. But I mean, we did not have the opportunity, as you know, these things came in. We just wanted to give, in case you weren't going to go with the recommendation. We know that Bethel Park really likes to have their calendar early, so we wanted to come with at least some possible other solutions. If you're not going to go with that recommendation, that you would have. So we didn't get an opportunity to show them this, because this is kind of just from the feedback that we got within 1 week. We gave you a couple other options, so that's what we did. So we didn't get to show them that.
Mrs. Rule, yeah. I just want to mention that I did receive all the emails too, as everybody else has said. Not one of the emails I received from anybody mentioned that I want the starting date because it is going to be best for the education of the students. Our superintendent is recommending the early start date because he feels it is best for the students of the district, which is why I voted no on the amendment, and I'll be voting no on the amendment because I think we should just keep his recommendation, because his recommendation was for best for students. That's just my thoughts on it.
I understand that, Dave. The rationale is that the more days you get in before the standardized testing, the better your students are going to do. But what's reasonable? I mean, you could argue, don't just start on the 7th rather than the 14th, or start at the beginning of August.
You could have all types.
So, I mean, there's a variety of things to consider, just besides just how many days you have in before the standardized test.
I understood all of those arguments, which is why I don't want to micromanage it, and I'm going to leave it to the person who has the educational expertise.
If you want to amend it, just make sure we get it right. That's
right.
All.
That's
just
all.
Make sure we know what you amended so that we don't put the wrong thing out. That's the only thing I ask.
Because right now you are starting at August 26th is the amendment.
Yeah.
Well, that's the amendment. I mean, you know, you can vote on it and see if it passes, and if not, then you can come up with something different.
Yeah.
It's fixing the length of the school year, so you do need 5.
Can I call the question?
That's what I was saying.
Okay.
All right.
Ask for the vote. Yeah.
Yes. Okay.
Can I ask a question? Mr. Amos has said, and I concur, I agree too, but I do agree with the audience. I agree. I mean, it's like I sound like I'm not making anything, no decision here. But one thing we could say is to have a compromise. There's a proposal with 3 and 4. We amended 3. 4, option 4 here was another one. Maybe we could say between the two, it didn't sound like we had a consensus that we wanted definitely 3 or definitely 4. I mean, we're talking about, do we want to, well, I guess 3 seems
we
to be the one that we have.
The one we're voting on is 3.
3, I know. I know that.
Still,
I know that.
Still conversation.
So is 4 really ruled out then, right? So 4 is out.
No, you could vote on the amendment and vote it down if you want to discuss the other option, the other amendment.
Or you can amend it again.
Or you can, yeah.
But that's why I'm wondering if we had enough discussion on four, just to see if three was not the best for the student option. I mean, three and four is, you know, we have three and four. Is three the best for the student, or is four the best for the student? Mm-hmm.
Yes, so, I think three is the best for the student.
Well, why don't we make it real clear and vote on the amended motion right now, the August 26th. If you do not want that one, you vote it down, and you can propose another amendment. So this way you know what you're voting on, all right? Am I clear now? You're voting on the amendment that says August 26th. The motion is amended. If you don't want it, you vote it down. If you want it, you vote it up. Okay. So, you ready for the question? All those in favor to have the start date of August 26th?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
No.
Maybe we need to have a roll call. I can't really tell how many.
Well, how do you vote, Connie? Huh? That would be the determining factor, right?
Oh.
Now.
No.
Okay, then it's
bad. Then that failed. So,
then it's failed.
Motion failed. Okay. Now, back. You want to amend it?
Wait, well, now you're just I'd like to call a roll call.
Make a new motion.
I'd like to call a roll call on that. I'm not sure that that did fail.
Well, Mr. Amtus, Mrs. Buckley, and
I think it was a 4-3.
No. So that's three of the four people.
We don't have five people. We need okay. five.
Mm-hmm. You need five?
You need five.
You
okay.
need five. Okay. So now we need a new one.
Okay, I'll make the amendment now. I'll make the amendment to modify.
No, it's not an amendment at this point. Now
it's, okay.
it's a new motion, right?
I will make a motion to adopt the calendar number 3 and modify it by moving the school start date back by 2 days. And
which would be what date?
Let me start grab date. Here.
August 22nd.
8th.
28th.
That's no. We want four. We want four. We want four, right? No, three.
I don't want four. I want you what you're saying.
Three would be the 28th.
Well, which one, Jim, are you?
Hang on. What did you say before?
I said move it to August 28th and take away January 2nd and 3rd.
Oh, that's too late.
Oh, that's too late.
That's way too late.
Well, then we have Labor Day after that. That's not too late. No, 3-day weekend.
Okay, I make a motion to adopt option number 4. That'll give us a 21st start date and end on the 4th.
I second that.
Okay. Okay, that is option 4, right?
Option 4.
Start with a start date of August 21st ending on June 4th.
Correct.
And that doesn't touch the January date, so the parents in the audience or parents at home who are upset about their Christmas vacation, that's not being moved. Because you folks don't have that in front of you, just to make it clear.
Are there any other questions or comments?
And the last day would be June 4th.
Yes, the last day would be June 4th. Right. Okay. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed?
Aye.
How many opposed? Were there two?
5-2.
Mr. Amnes and Mrs. Douglas. 5-2. Honey, okay. You voted yes?
Yes.
Okay, that's 5-2, so that passed.
Okay. Motion passed. Start date will be August 21st. Ending date will be June 4th.
You're done, but I just want to make one clarifying point. Okay, it's nothing to do with student days, but just so you, oh no, you did. You left it right where it was at.
You're good. Yeah. You didn't move teacher days.
Yeah.
We're good. Thank you.
Which, interestingly enough, was the start of the school date this year.
Say that again.
August 21st was the start of the school date of our school year this year.
Yeah. Okay.
And I hope the folks in the audience realize that we don't take this lightly. We do listen. We read all those emails. We talk to all the people. But the bottom line is we can't have what this person wants, because there's so many different options. It really gets rather.
And I would just say, you know, so do we. We try
exactly.
our best.
You folks, yeah.
I don't know that we
and
know.
And the Federation is involved in this. They make an approval. So it's not just one group. It represents a lot of different people.
Okay, Mrs. Buckley, number 7.
Oh, thank you.
Before we go on to that, can I make a comment? Dr. P, I'd like to thank you. You made up 4 different calendars at least. I don't know how many you threw away before you showed us the 4.
Yeah.
Well, and thank Ms. Wells, she and the team there, they helped out a lot too to try to double check and count everything to make sure we have all the days. So we appreciate that.
Yeah, there's more involved in this than some people might realize as far as the regulations and all the expectations and so on. This is quite an endeavor. So thank you. Okay.
Item 7.
Moving on to number 7, 2018-2019 change in school calendar.
Is there a second?
Second.
Okay. Any questions or comments?
Yeah, I just don't think we should take the day away from spring break because we put so many days at the end of the year for makeup days. For some in our community, that's a holy day. So I am going to vote no on using that day for the makeup.
Any other questions or comments? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
Aye.
Aye.
Two, okay, motion passes as stated. Pam, would you please take personnel?
Sure. Okay, there are 1,
13.
2, 3,
13.
4, 13, thank you. There are 13 items.
You need a cup of water.
Under personnel. This is new for you folks. There are 13 items under personnel. Does anyone want any held out?
I do. I want 5C. 1, 2.
Wait, go slowly.
5C.
5C. 1, 2, 3, 6.
5C. 1, 5, 6.
No, not 5.
Not 5.
Okay.
6.
6, okay.
12, 13, 14.
12, 13, 14.
15, and 17.
Okay.
Any others? Okay. I would like to then move under personnel committee 1, approval of extra duty responsibility program, 2, acceptances of resignations, 3, approval of leave of absence, 4, approval to extend sabbatical leave of absence, 5A, B, C, 4, 5, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 16, 6, appointment of outside event coordinator, 7, individual memorandum of agreement with the Bethel Park Federation of Teachers, 8, individual memorandum of agreement with the Bethel Park Federation of Teachers, 9, memorandum of agreement with the Bethel Park Federation of Teachers, 10, memorandum of agreement with the Bethel Park Federation of Teachers, 11, attainment of status of a professional employees, 12, appointment of personnel to the 2018-19 alternative education program, 13, approval of substitutes.
Is there a second?
Second.
Okay. Any questions or comments? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries as stated.
Now I'd like to move 5C, 1, 2, 3. Oh, can I do it all together?
Yeah, okay. That's fine.
Yeah.
5C, 1, 2, 3, 6, 12, 13, 14, 15, and 17.
Second.
Okay. Been moved and seconded. Any questions or comments?
Yes, I have a comment.
you guys will please indulge me, I wrote an email to the board and superintendent on September 7th. I'm going to read part of it because I've been holding that, all of these, and I know you guys don't even have what these positions are on your agenda. I can't read the whole email because there's people's names in it, but I'll start at the end. Underscores our need as a board to ask to vote on staffing changes to have a cohesive picture of the district needs as well as building needs. This is why I've asked for some kind of spreadsheet or chart that compares needs to changes and keeps a running total. When you're making these recommendations to us, do you have an adequate method of tracking what we have in a given position and location versus what we need, as well as rates of turnover in said position? If so, is there a reason we can't be given access through Google Drive, since we are ultimately responsible for making the decisions? We just received enrollment numbers from August by building, and while it does state how many classes in each grade in elementary schools, which is a great improvement, it doesn't clarify how many sections in each core subject for the middle and high schools. It also does not state how many IEPs are in each classroom, whether they have one-on-one requirements or small group, and how many paras are there to tend to them, or how many periods of general aids or paras to provide more one-on-one instruction or assistance, effectively reducing class sizes. This renders enrollment information nearly useless for decision-making purposes. While I applaud the board's commitment to not raising taxes, I will not continue to do so at the detriment of our students. I'm not saying this is necessarily what's happening. What I am saying is that I'm not given enough information to ensure that it's not what's happening. For this reason, until I am given adequate information that I can assess more than 1 hour prior to a meeting and more than a verbal explanation of the need, I will be voting no on all position closures and part-time positions. I do vote yes on the position closures. I changed my position on that. I get one response to this email agreeing that they'd like to hear the district's response. I have not yet gotten any of this information. Since this time, we've had a lot of part-time positions in the paraprofessionals particularly. There are 8 up right now as part-time positions, and I don't think that many part-time positions in such a crucial area reflect the value we place on these employees or promote retention in a position where stability is critical. So I'll continue holding all of those part-time positions up and vote no until I get better information to vote yes on.
Dr. P, can I ask a question? The part-time paras, they would normally not be switching a child in the middle of the day. Is that correct?
Well, to answer that question, I mean, I think the needs fluctuate based upon what, you know, children need in a given building. IEPs they come up throughout the year. They're not necessarily at one certain beginning time. Kids move in, kids move out, kids need more needs, kids need less needs. Those things fluctuate. So yes, they could, to answer your question, they could be working with more than one student at a given time, or they could be working with one student.
That's not what I'm saying. If a student is supposed to have a para all day long, he would normally have the same para, wouldn't he?
That's not a guarantee, but that would be, you know, that would be something that we would work towards. That would be preferred, but it may not always work out that way.
Okay.
Is that day in, day out, or just on any given day that you work towards that?
Well, I would say that, you know, we make sure in any situation that we meet the needs that are required by the IEP, and when consistency of it is available, then we utilize that with the same parent. So I'm not sure how to answer your question. Is it day in, day out?
The same para for a child that has an IEP, day in, day out. With this high rate of turnover, I just don't see how we have consistency in these positions.
If you have turnover or people quit positions, you can't possibly always have the exact same person. If that's your question, right? I mean, people have the right to be employed, and if they choose to take a position elsewhere, then they're no longer here.
I would like to make the comment that evidently you don't like the part-time positions, and that you're right, but the part-time positions is a very effective, cost-effective way for the school district to hire people. And there are a lot of people who want to work part-time. They don't necessarily want to put in a full day. So I don't think having part-time employees is necessarily bad. I wouldn't say it's necessarily good, but I mean, I don't think it should be viewed as it's just because you hire two part-time people rather than one full-time person as being a necessarily bad thing.
I don't necessarily say so either, but I'm not given information to provide a reasonable decision-making process to rationalize that. What I am given is information that we have a high rate of turnover and not that good of retention in these part-time positions. So that kind of leads me the other way.
I'm sorry. As I had stated at the committee meeting, I believe, you know, this was something that I did ask some information. We didn't put a formal survey out, but many of the folks in Allegheny County at the superintendent's meeting are finding themselves also, even some that offer some benefits, struggling to fill the positions. Mm-hmm. So I don't have exact statistics. We didn't send that out, but I did ask the question to see if somebody was having much more success, what they might be doing.
If you read the one ads in the paper, Bethel Park School District is not the only school district that has openings, whether they be full or part-time. There are many. This is a discussion of when we get together at Pathfinder and there's different school districts there, we have this discussion. It's not just Bethel Park.
And that's fine. If I'm given the information I asked for, I may start voting yes.
Regarding the vacancies and so forth, though, Dr. Pasquarelli, you've assured us that we are using a temporary agency when we need to fill these positions if we don't have a person in there, right?
That's our goal. Every morning, Mrs. Sutton, along with the building principals, look to see how they might be able to fill that. We have building level substitutes that are utilized as paras. Some of those folks would, to be truthful and transparent, would rather be serving as a substitute teacher. However, we make sure that we do our best to meet the needs. And if we're made aware of a situation where that's not occurring, we address it as soon as possible.
Thank you.
Any other comments?
Yeah, I have one other comment. If we need a paraprofessional for half a day in one building, say the morning, and a half a day paraprofessional in the afternoon in another building, we can't necessarily just take that one para and move them to the other building. So, I mean, there is more flexibility some ways by doing it this way. So,
I have a question based on your question. When's the last time we posted for a full-time para? Because that's not always the circumstance, correct?
What's not always the circumstance?
Where you need them in one building for a half a day and another building for a half a day.
Is it always the circumstance? It may not always be the circumstance.
Well, I guess my question is, if that's not the circumstance where we need them in two different locations, is it always beneficial to just hire two part-times as opposed to one full-time, besides by the budget?
So to answer your question, to the best of my knowledge right now, I don't have that in front of me, but I don't believe that the district, prior to myself as the superintendent, has been hiring full-time paras. I mean, it's been quite some time.
It's been quite a while.
If you look at the seniority list, I'm just being honest, it predates me by quite a bit to the point where the district was moving towards part-time, to answer that question. So exactly when the last time it was, we'd have to check the seniority list. To your point about, is there times that you could do that? Again, I repeat what I was saying earlier, which is part of the struggle to provide you with the exact information, because this information is fluid. It changes weekly, daily, monthly. So you could think that the person is going to need this service. Just one child might need it for a whole day, but then midway through it, the next IEP, they may need a half, and another kid who needed a half or only in these subjects needs a whole. It fluctuates.
It's very complicated.
So it's very difficult on any given day when you have IEP meetings, and some of them are planned annually, and some of them happen on a need basis, it's very difficult to be able to produce a document that says by building when you can't move them between buildings, how you make sure that you cover that.
So how, if you don't have any kind of document or guidance,